The session today is about English and skills connecting the dots. So the aims of my session are that by the end of the session, first we will explore the skills needed both for education and employment. After that, we look at the crucial role of 21st century skills. Then you'll also have an opportunity to experience some activities that illustrate how we can integrate global skills / 21st century skills in our teaching practice. And after that, you will have a chance to analyze the activities that I demonstrate, how you will adapt those for your learners in your context. And the last but not the least, the approach you can take in your classrooms to, you know, connect the dots, as my session says, connect the development of skills and language ability.
Hi, Kamini ma'am. So on hearing these questions, I feel that all the questions stand good for both a student and for an employee.
Okay, great. Anybody else who has a similar view or a different view?
Yes, I have. I have the same similar view that only education can fulfill the need of that employment. Mm-hmm. All these questions can be helpful for the employment only then if we inculcate the all these skills in the education. So I think this is quite important.
All right. Okay, so I'll add a little twist in the tale. What 21st century skills are integrated in these aspects? Whatever you can see on the screen, what 21st century skills do these questions subsume in them? Harsha, you want to say?
Yeah, it's communication, collaboration, creative thinking, and use of ICT.
Sure. And, okay. Somebody else.
Problem solving. Yeah.
Somebody else. Anybody else would like to respond?
Saying critical thinking. Yeah. This response in the chat.
Yeah. Problem solving. Decision. Correct. So, in other words.
Also somewhere I think we look for self-management, like how is a person managing himself or herself when it comes to whether, you know, working in teams or carrying himself. So as we look at many things like dressed appropriately, punctual, it is all about how you're managing yourself first.
Correct.
Then moving on to you know, how you're managing a group or a team or how you're solving problems. And then comes the thinking part, because that is the last thing that you would be able to demonstrate once you are in a team or in your place of work or in school.
Correct. Correct.
In addition to that, use of technology in this 21st century is more essential. That the positive use should be encouraged.
Yes. Yes. Digital literacies should be there. Correct. So we can agree that these global skills, 21st century skills, are needed in education and employment. You know, you need to know all this to be able to survive, to be able to progress, to be able to deal with the competing demands of the industry, the market, the education field, all of that. Yeah. Okay. So do you think, I did a little summary. So whatever you've pointed out, whatever the questions are, I have correlated it to 21st century skills. So whatever you said is very, very right. There is something on leadership and flexibility. And as somebody said, self-management, self-direction. Can they explain things clearly? Yes, that is also there. Okay. The assessment of teaching of 21st century skills. So there are four profiles they've created. That is ways of working, ways of thinking, tools for working, and ways of living in the world. So this framework is used globally, and it subsumes all the 21st century skills. And that's how they've defined it. Now, I'd like to talk about high quality teaching. How does this translate into our classroom? What is it that we can do? So high quality English language teaching has two potential functions. Developing language skills as English teachers, it's our job to develop students' language ability. But in addition to that, developing 21st century skills as well. Can we do this in tandem? I believe, strongly believe that first of all, English language teaching or the communicative methodologies that we use in our classroom, learner-centered methods that we use in our classroom, they complement the development of 21st century skills. So we as teachers are in a unique position to contribute, to students' development of language ability and skills at the same time. How do we do that? We need to assess the process that we use in our classroom to teach. So for example, I have worked in a school in Delhi for the longest time. And also typically in a traditional classroom, or even if it's not a traditional classroom, there is a lot of pressure on the teachers to complete the syllabus because exams are coming. So we basically focus on the content. I need to finish the syllabus, but we need to assess the process. And by process, I mean the methods that we use to deliver the content to the students. Can we deliver the content in such a manner so that in the process, students develop these 21st century skills? Yeah, we need to realize the full potential of learner-centered methods and not just keep it to simple pair work and group work. What is it that we can do? How can I set up my activity so that it brings in an element of problem solving? It brings in an element of critical thinking. It brings in an element of collaboration and communication and so on and so forth. Okay, so now we are going to, there's a balloon challenge for you people. So imagine you are going on a balloon adventure together with your group for a long time. Okay, and you need to select 8 essential things that you want to take with you. Okay, so now you are going to see a poll. Okay, Ashwath is going to launch a poll which has 10 items on it. You need to select 8 that you think you should take with you on this balloon adventure. The thing is that it's not a joyride, okay? As the balloon travels, it gets heavier and it loses height. So you need to make a decision as a group of 115 people here, okay? That which 3 items should be dropped. Now, as a group, I would like you to, from these, you've chosen 8. 1, 2, 3. What are the 8? I'm sorry. Sorry. So the thing is, bottle of water is the first priority. Everybody is going to take. Then you have binoculars. Adventurous spirit. You also have sunglasses. So what you have missed is people don't want to take a hat and people don't want to take an empty bladder, which I think is very important, but never mind. So you've dropped the hat and empty ladder. So we now have 8 items minus the hat and an empty bladder. You as a group now need to make the list to 5 items out of 8. So hat and empty bladder is no more on the list. Out of the 8 items on the screen, you have to make the list to 5. Please have a discussion with each other and decide what 3 items you should draw.
Yeah. Ma'am, hat and sneakers with high socks is a minimum, the lowest percentage.
No. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
No,
so then we can choose from the bottom 8. Yeah.
Yes. I apologize. I didn't see that. Yeah, so hat and high socks and no more on the list. So you can discuss it. The result is still visible to you so that you can see the items and you can unmute your mics, not the camera, but only the mic and have a discussion.
Hat and sneakers we can leave.
Hat is not there, na.
Okay, hat. So sneakers we have and bottle. Because as we are going up, so maybe we will get water if there will be rain.
Clothes. Who says clothes should be dropped? How will you go without clothes?
Yes, clothes are very important.
Important.
Ma'am, who is looking at us at such a ever place? Who is looking there?
But you still, what about it? It might be cold, it might rain. What about that? You will not need clothes.
Sunglasses we can drop out because we are in the
okay. So
we can drop sunglasses and sun protection lotion.
Okay, very bad. Sun protection is so important.
Yeah, lotion is not so important.
Okay. So less adventurous spirit. I don't think there is a scale there. Either you take it with you or you don't take it with you.
Yes, you that is not a material thing. That is a spirit.
Spirit we cannot drop out because with the help of the spirit only we can achieve the goal.
Yeah.
We can reach to the point.
No, spirit is it is inside us.
Inside us, we can't drop out. If you are going with the balloon, that it means that you have that spirit.
But the spirit don't have the weight.
But we can't drop it.
But spirit is the abstract thing. How could we drop that thing which is not existent? It is in our mind.
To achieve anything, it is very important.
Okay, all right. So I don't think, Ashwat, can you stop sharing the result now? Okay, now the thing is that
mobile phone.
So I don't think we can come to a conclusion right now as to what three items we should drop. Though there was a preference for leaving sunglasses, sun protection and binoculars. Mostly people said that, but that's okay. Now, did you enjoy the activity?
Yes.
Do you think you could do it in class, face to face?
Yes.
You think your students would enjoy it?
Yeah, definitely.
Sure. Yes.
So my question is, what skills were developed with this activity?
Critical thinking.
Problem solving.
Critical thinking.
Intellectual skills. Decision making is important.
So decision making, critical thinking.
Yes.
And, collaboration.
Yes.
Respecting to every
collaboration.
Opinion.
Self management.
Yes. Because all of you came from your experience that what you should take.
Prioritizing the thing.
Yes. Agree.
Critical thinking.
I'm going to summarize what you have just said.
Can we please mute ourselves and then type it in the chat box?
All right.
So,
yes, I think we should, for this decision, we have to first start with communication. So the first skill from four C's, here it is.
So have a look.
Yes.
We develop all these skills.
Self-direction and initiative.
So we have to have the collaboration, we have to have the communication, then critical thinking, all these things. So in total, we have reached or touched all the aspect.
Right. We are going to talk about this again when we think about how can you adapt this activity for your learners. I'm going to show you a scenario. Hang on. Okay, so this one is focused on employability skills. Okay, the first one was more on 21st century skills. This one is more on employability skills. So imagine there are a group of four people. They're at a stall in an exhibition. The name of the activity is Twist My Arm. When you have to twist somebody's arm, that means you want, what, when you twist somebody's arm, what does it mean? It's an idiom. Any ideas? When you twist somebody's
arm. To negotiate and to make.
Yes. Punish.
To make the other person do what you exactly want him to do.
Yes, exactly.
To oppose somebody.
Oppose or to convince somebody or to persuade somebody.
Convince.
Okay, so you're going to watch a little video where two people are trying to persuade the other two people to share their phone. But the other two are reluctant. Watch the video. And in video, I'm going to stop sharing my screen so that you can play the video.
I can see some stalls there. Is it just something you want to check? What is it? I think you want to check the latest phones.
Oh, yeah.
Let's have a look. Hi.
Hi. Good afternoon, ladies. How can we help you?
We were just like looking around if you wanted to check the best phones. I mean, anything that you all have.
Great. We have a few new phones which have been launched.
Okay.
Which one do you like? You want to pick on a few and then we can explain you some of the details.
That's the first. The first one, please.
Yeah, this is a good one, which has got a high storage memory and a fast. So that is high performance phone, which just been launched 3 days back.
Okay.
But can I just ask you for your numbers before we get on to these detailed discussions, please?
Can you take a picture? Wow, that's really clear. That's very nice.
It's ma'am. It's got the best in class camera. It's got portrait mode, it's got three lenses, so you get an ultra wide angle.
Okay.
So that's the best phone in the market right now.
Hmm. All right, sounds good. Yeah, any more options that you have?
Yes, we are happy to talk about. There are some finance schemes also which we want to speak to you about.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can just leave a number, that'll be really helpful.
I think we'd love to hear the schemes first.
Yeah,
because we prefer an EMI option. You know, we want a really nice phone, but then we don't
want to
like spend.
Right, so you're looking for finance schemes. And we can give you all the details of all the schemes,
mm-hmm.
all the features, so that then you can decide and come back to us. So if you can have your number there, that would be really helpful.
Yeah,
it's just a part of the policy and compliance, nothing on, we understand all regulations, so don't worry about.
I hope you won't share it with you.
No, it's not going to be. It's company policy, so it's not going to be shared.
Okay.
We are just sure.
Okay. That is fine, please note down the numbers. Yeah.
Thank you very much. And so I'm taking down your number. And we will contact you soon.
Okay,
is that fair?
Yeah.
All right.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks. Bye.
What was the whole deal? What do you think was happening?
So negotiating skills and communication is important. And for convincing the customer, I think the skills are important. Is that a collaboration?
Yeah. Can something like this be done in the class?
Sure, we can do this. Yeah.
Role play, maybe?
Role play, skit, we can.
Yeah. In this particular case, it was, in this particular case, it was the focus, language focus, functional language focus was negotiation skills under the overarching theme, overarching communication umbrella. So in this case, the focus was negotiation skills. It was a role play, can be easily done in the class. There are lots of opportunities, lot of scenarios that you can present to the students to be able to do this. So the next one is interview skills. So there are three people: school principal, there's a nominee for the head boy, head girl, and there's a feedback provider. And this is a graphical representation of how the activity will happen. I'll give you 30 seconds to have a quick read. Again, my question is, what skills were developed by this activity?
Communication.
Communication is important, I think.
Yeah. Also, there was this collaboration, confidence. Confidence to face a situation and come up with apt answers. Over and above, it was it was talking about constructive feedback.
So it's communication skills and problem solving attitude, I think.
What skills does the feedback provider develop?
Self-direction and self-leadership.
Reflection. Awareness. Yes.
Analytical is also, ma'am.
Yes.
Because the self-analysis is still going on.
Yeah. Awareness of strengths and areas to further work on. Ability to give feedback. Yeah. How can you adapt these activities for your students? You experienced three activities. Balloon challenge. If I asked you, how would you adapt it for your primary learners? How would you do that?
We can give them, may I, ma'am?
Yeah.
We can give them various situations for group and pair also. We can conduct such activities. In that situations, they will discuss among their peers or with the group members that they will do with this, and they will perform the activity, and other groups will observe them and they will discuss on them, and they will give them the feedback, and
could it be
they will share them.
Could it be 10 things they want to take on a picnic possible?
Yeah, sure, they can do this activity.
Yeah. 10 things.
Yeah.
Which they are carry in their school bag.
Yes.
Yeah.
The bag is so heavy. Very nice idea. The bag is so heavy. What is it that you should get rid of? You know?
Can it also be about 10 changes that they would want to see in the class? So maybe what is obstructing them in learning, and it would be more like a giving a constructive feedback to teacher and the peers on the way.
Yes, so totally depends on the level of the students you are dealing with. You can adapt this activity for primary, middle, senior school. Yes, so you have to think about what resonates with your student. It's a very simple activity, and with the activity, so many skills besides language can be developed. What about the next one? Twist my arm. Any ideas?
This activity, what I can connect to is like more like, making them think how they are going to put their point forward in terms of developing debate skills or public speaking skills or, writing a persuasive letter. I mean,
yes.
So this can be like initial activity to actually, kind of giving them a warm up kind of a thing.
To set the context, very, very rightly said. It could also be something like, let's say in a school, the school is saying we are going to work all Saturdays instead of only two Saturdays. So the student body has to negotiate with the principal and the vice principal and so on and so forth. It could be a situation like that as well.
It could be a discussion, a healthy discussion on government decisions taken in terms of, you know, older students. So who are 12 plus or so.
Yes, so some kind of interview skills.
Yeah.
Interview skills, interview for being a class monitor, possible for primary school. Interview for maybe applying for an institution after 12. So all this comes into play. You need to consider your students, what their needs are, and adapt the activity accordingly. Okay, now, what is it? So this is a task card, something like this you could give to the students, change it according to the needs of your students and the context, and something like this could be given. And it's important to give them some preparation time, not just stand up and perform, because that really helps. So what do you do in the classroom to bring about all of these things? How do you integrate the development of skills with your regular teaching? Have a look. Yes, I mean, the thing is, all of us are tuned in with the approach, the methodologies, but it's also about bringing about an active change in the way we teach. Am I using learner-centered methods? Am I making sure that students are collaborating for any kind of activity, any kind of things? And it does just doesn't apply to English teaching. It can apply to any subject. Yeah, so it's all about bringing about that conscious change in the classroom. The next slide tells you the approach that you can take to connect skills and language development. One final slide. So somebody just asked me about learner autonomy. So increasing metacognition and self-directed learning, which means ensuring that students practice to assess what they're good at, what they're not good at. So bringing in learner journals, learner portfolios, reflection tasks where students can assess themselves, what are their strengths, what are the areas they need to further work on. And once they are able to do that, they will be able to sustain themselves outside the class. They will have the ability to look for resources that they need for learning outside the class. Of course, the teacher has to guide them, but learner autonomy can be increased by making students capable in class so that they can manage their learning outside class more effectively. Yeah? So that's some, these are a few things you can do in your classes. I tried this activity with all of you are teachers and educators. Similarly, you can try it with your teachers and again pose the same question, how would they adapt it for their learners? Yeah, but you also need to tap into those teachers' background, the experience that they bring, and whatever activities you do need to be relevant to them. And not because you like that activity.
Okay.
Only then it will work. The gap is, the thing is, mostly from my experience, and I maybe things have changed, but the thing is that when students study English at school, one, it is very, very, it is not considered as an important subject because students focus on English, math, science, and all of those subjects, because possibly students can score higher and they feel English is easy. But they realize its importance when they start applying for for you know courses in academic institutions,
yes,
or for a job, and that's when the need arises for spoken English skills. Connecting this to your question about employers, so most employers or recruiters will say, "I want a person who has good communication skills, not just technical skills." So the problem is when companies recruit, some of them have, I mean, things have changed now, but there is no assessment for English, no formal assessment for English. So there could be, so the employers could integrate some kind of an assessment for English, one. Second, the jobs that are there in the market, the way our country works and the way the industry works, they're not mapped to a certain language level. Yes. Anybody can do any job. So if the candidate who's applying for a job is clear that for, let's say, a job as an entry level data entry person in X company, I need to be A2 or B1 level on the CFR scale. You know?
Yes.
So if the jobs are mapped to a certain level of language, then students can ensure that, you know, their language ability is such, but then our systems are such that they are not, there is nowhere where they can go and get their level checked, assess it, somebody can then give them some kind of guidance as in schools and in colleges. So this is something, you know, a big change has to happen for this to come into play. The way we teach in schools, the way we teach in higher education, with the new education policy, the vision is very, very different. But of course, for anything to happen takes a long time. So the gap will exist, you know, for a while. But as teachers, we need to make an active change to bring about in our classroom, a change in our classroom, so that we can make our students' future ready, so that nobody tells them that, okay, you don't have these skills. You only have technical skills. Okay, so for example, you mean for yourself or your students?
Yeah, I mean myself and my students. Okay.
So, I mean, I was referring to this assessment, assessment of 21st century skills framework. There is a recent report that Oxford University Press shared, which has, you know, the frameworks that are used worldwide for assessment of 21st century skills for students and teachers, and what kind of, you know, things should a teacher have? What is it that you can do? So you should have the right attitude, you should have the knowledge, and you should have the experience. But where are you on that scale? You need to assess that. I will share that with Firki for everyone to see. It's a really, really interesting read. And you can delve deeper into activities also that you can do for younger and older learners to develop different 21st century skills. So it has lots of examples and lots of research, you know, gone into it. So I'll share that. I think that will be really, really useful. So now the thing is, if they're rural, in rural areas, they've never seen the language, you know, so for absolute beginners, you do not take a book as such and start teaching, because they need to first become literate. They need to know the alphabet first. So if from my experience, having taught really, really, you know, starters rather. So I think the approach that goes into is, there is an approach that we use, which is look, say, and repeat. So that's how they become familiar with the letters. And I think at that level, the whole idea is to introduce vocabulary more than grammar. If by the end of 2 months, students are able to write 3 sentences to introduce themselves, that I am so-and-so, I live here, and I have 2 brothers and a sister. I think that is an achievement. So when we say beginners, you do not imagine that a beginner by the end of it will start speaking fluently. What you need to do is go step by step and introduce a lot of vocabulary using look, say, repeat and write approach. Yeah. It would be a good idea to enroll yourself for some kind of MOOCs that are massive open online courses. Host, British Council hosts lots of MOOCs for teachers. The website, the platform is called Future Learn. If you type Future Learn British Council, you need to engage with your peer group.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. And not just your students, because students level is here. You are here.
Yeah.
You need to engage with somebody who's at your level or higher to be able to develop. So you need to break it down further. You need to make groups. Maybe you can rely on students in the class to help you monitor. So just like teachers have classroom assistants, you can have students as your assistants. Okay. And if you have 50 students, how many groups of six will you make? Probably, how many will you make? I don't know. Maybe 8, 10 of them. But you could have, students monitoring so that the activity that you do can be delivered well with semblance, and there is decorum in the class. So rely on your students, the brightest students, and I'm sure they will certainly enjoy the responsibility. Yeah. So the learner autonomy can help. I mean, this is another way of learner autonomy. When you give students some responsibility, they will do it, because and what they will learn from it will, take on that leadership role. They take on the role of dealing with conflict, if any, or stuff like that. Yeah, so typically all of us have mixed ability classes. Even if we check their level and put them in one class, it will still be a mixed ability class. So what you need to consider is when you make groups, there is a bright student and there is a weak student. But then the bright student always takes more opportunity they're more assertive and they take more chances, they contribute more. The group is balanced. Let's say there are students who finish things quickly. So for early finishers, maybe we could have some tasks that once they finish, they do something else, or support others in the class who are still not there. So you need to think of activities that you can use to engage those. Okay, so when you, syllabus design is a field on its own. So what kind of syllabus do you want? It could be a thematic syllabus. It could be a functional syllabus. So if it is a thematic syllabus, that means what kind of themes will they explore in that spoken English skills? For example, could it be food? Could it be cinema? Could it be the environment? Could it be festivals? Whatever. And they have to have a template which will run through across the lessons that they will use. So it could be a reading, it could be a listening activity, and then after that listening and reading activity, what kind of a communicative task they could integrate in that. Can there be a reflection task that can be integrated? Can there be a mingle? So, there are so many ways of designing a syllabus. This is just one example, like from the top of my head. Lots of challenges. Nobody wants to get trained. Nobody wants to get trained. So the challenge is that they'll say, well, I know everything. How can I, why should I learn? But unless the training and the outcome of it is tied to their performance. So let's say the training is done. 2 months later, show me how you have improved. Unless the employer asks them that, people don't take it seriously. It's as simple as that. So that can happen very gradually. So if you tell them once, okay, why don't you contribute in the group? They still won't. But that's a process that you'll have to one, ensure that there are opportunities for them to contribute. So the activities that you organize or set up in class should lend itself to the whole idea of that students are able to communicate and collaborate. First is that. Second, gradually, you know, they will turn around, but you'll have to keep up the effort. It's not going to happen in 2 days, you know. So that's
the thing. So it's a time that we give them, with them. Yeah.
So when the new words are introduced, are they high currency words? Are they absolutely no new words that they don't know? So you have to first clarify the meaning of the word. There are lots of different ways in which the meaning of the word can be clarified. So they say meaning, pronunciation, form, MPF. When we teach any new vocabulary, first, the meaning has to be clear. It could be using realia, it could be using a picture, it could be using the dictionary. There are so many different ways in which the meaning of the word can be clarified. Meaning, then you stress on how the word is pronounced. You practice drilling with them and then show them how it is written. Once all these steps are done, then There should be some kind of controlled practice where they actually use the word, maybe fill in the blanks or something like that. Following it up with freer practice where they have an opportunity to use the word in speaking or writing. So that's how new words are introduced. And they have to be introduced in context. So let's say there is a little paragraph or there is a text about or there is a story. You introduce words in context. So they read the story. Then before reading the story, you ask them what is the story about, you know, and then we get to the clarifying meaning of the words. Because if you give them the text beforehand and they don't know the meaning of the word, the story will not make sense. So clarify the meaning of the word first, then give them the story. The word wall that you're talking about can be used as a revision tool, but not to introduce the words. To introduce the word, you first have to give them the meaning. How will the students know otherwise? Sir, there are lots of resources that are available online. Which you can, if you go into Teaching English, British Council site, that is for teachers, and there is Learn English for kids, there is Learn English for teenagers. You will find lesson plans, activities, games with the procedure and the materials needed and things like that. So these could be easy activities that you can use in your classroom.